Hey everybody, welcome to episode 45, I believe, of the Five Barista Files. Today is a Monday, August 22nd. I'm a little late again this week, another Monday episode. Sundays, weekends have been very busy. Life has been very busy lately, so I hope you all forgive me. And I'm going to try and get through this episode in under an hour because I need to leave in under an hour here. So, all right, week in review. I've been doing more packing this week, getting ready for school, getting ready for the apartment. I moved a load down last weekend. I'm still packing stuff. I keep thinking of stuff that I need to pack, and the list never gets smaller. So, and like some of it's incredibly awkward to move. Fly, get out of here, fly. My KitchenAid mixer, my Crazy Monkey's game winder, and my spinning wheel all need to go down there. But they're not packable, so get out of my face, you stupid fly. So I don't really know when or how I'm going to get them down there. I just don't know. So it's going, but slowly. I have been cleaning all the things lately. It looks I'm downstairs today because it wasn't worth the effort of putting the laptop upstairs. But everything's a mess, if you can see. What a mess my areas are, but the floors, the walls, all of that looks much better. The bathroom looks better. It's like a reverse nesting. Like, I feel like I can't leave until all of the cleaning chores that I should be doing while I'm living here are finally done, because terrible housekeeper, but now that I'm actually moving out, like, I must clean everything. My husband helped too, God bless him. He totally recalked the tub. He fixed a issue in the floor, like crawled underneath the house and jacked up the floor. He's been doing great too, so it's been good. He also built me a dye table. I don't think I mentioned it, but my apartment is completely carpeted and it's brand new carpet. Now, when I'm dying out in my kitchen, which just has a normal floor. So if I spill dye on it, I wipe it up with a sponge or my sock. And it's gone. But on this carpet, it's a wool carpet. So obviously the dyes are going to stay if I get them on the rug. So we've been a little concerned about what we're going to do because I am going to be dying down there. So he's built me a dye table. It's nice and tall. It's a 36 inch height, which is, I'm not sure if 36 inches is standard cabinet height or not, but our current counters are 2 inches below standard because his grandmother was a very small woman. So I'm like bent in half. I'm 5'9 was a remainder, and it's very uncomfortable for me to dye in our kitchen. So I have a nice high dye table. It's 36 inches high, so 3 feet high. It's 2 feet deep and 3 feet long, so it's this good sized huge table, and it's got a ridge running around all four sides so that if a dye bottle spills, the dye will stay on the table at least long enough for me to clean it up. He's going to caulk all around the edges, and then we're going to seal it with poly so that it won't stain. And if it stains the wood, I don't really care. It's a work tool bench. It's not a piece of furniture that I'm going to display. So I don't really care if it gets dyed, but it will be sealed. So at least it will be protected a little bit from all the water and everything that I'll be using. So I'm super excited about it. I don't know how it's going to fit in the truck. We didn't think about that when we built it. But we'll get there. We'll figure it out. I did get my canopy. I talked about that last week. I'd ordered a canopy from hayneedle.com, which it's actually getundercover.com is the company. I'm going to add a little bit of video to the end of this video that shows me putting it up. I'm probably going to take the audio out and maybe insert music or something just because my actual camera that I take pictures with has a video function, but there's a really high-pitched whine that goes on in the background, and that whine is annoying. So I think I'm gonna edit the, there's not a lot of audio anyway, it's just about me futzing with this canopy, but I did get it up, it's awesome, I'm really impressed with it, so that's a good thing. And then the only other thing this week happened last, oh no, there's two things. I got an email last night from Mary Bird, who's the director of Fibermania, which is a show that I do in October at the University of Maine campus in Orono. It's the closest show to Maine. I got an email last night that they're canceling it. They didn't have enough vendors sign up, so they had to cancel. They had to say no, that they couldn't do it this year. I am beyond disappointed that they are not going to do it. I really enjoyed myself at Fibromania last year. I enjoyed having a show that it's an easy day trip to. It's a weekend show. I'm bummed. You guys will benefit because that'll mean that I'll be able to continue to put stuff in the online shop instead of stopping to fill the inventory for the show. But I'm still bummed. I like to see people in real life. I like to go to the shows and meet with my people and see them. I was also, I think, going to be on a panel. I hit my tooth. That really hurt. I was going to be on a panel about entrepreneurship, and I was going to be able to talk about the Five Barista Files and Highland Handmades and how I was making a living at it and that. That would have been really cool. So I'm bummed, but what are you going to do? And the last thing, I've had a lot of people ask me lately about the challenging sock yarn, challenging colorway, regardless of the base yarn. I am working on those orders as fast as I can. I have to make a supply order. I can't call until noon because they don't open until 9 on the West Coast. But it's going to be about 2 weeks before I have any more in stock. I have everybody's custom orders written down. I will get to them as soon as I can, but it is going to take a little while, and I appreciate your patience. So that's been the week in review. Knitting. I am still working on my sock. It didn't get a whole lot of love this week. I would be okay with knitting this in the car, but I'm at the gusset increases, which means that I need to worry about the pattern and writing and whatnot. And of course, I always use, when I'm knitting, I use the guidelines put forth in Wendy Johnson's Socks from the Toe Up to see how many stitches do I use for the heel turn and the flap and all that. How far do I increase to? I always use Wendy's ratios as a guideline and then edit them to make them my own. But the book is in on the coast in my apartment. It's not here. So I don't have it. So I'm stuck a little bit right now. But that's what I have done so far. This camera is gonna it does look at that. Doesn't that look nice? Let me tip it right side up. I'm still really enjoying the pattern. I'm still really enjoying the pattern in the colorway. This is what the bottom of the foot looks like in plain stuck in it. So it's, purples and grays and whites. I love it. I think I will send this out to test knitters as soon as I get the first sock done because I don't predict that the second sock will take me very long to do. So I did write up the chart. I did what I figured was a repeat, and then I drew out what I'd done. You probably can't see this very well because I did it in pencil. Focus. There we go. So I drew out what I had done, and I actually had done more than a repeat because this line that I drew across here is where it repeats. So it's a 20-row repeat. It's not perfectly symmetrical, which means that these crosses that come in, these slip stitches that come in from the sides, like you'll see this one starts here and then it starts again up here, they don't correspond to the same row on the other side. My inner OCD is whining a little bit about that, but it's just the way it works. And it's totally fine. I double, triple, quadruple checked it. It's the way it's supposed to be. It's just really sort of interesting. So the sock is making progress. Hat pattern, I have four test knitters waiting for the pattern. I just need to photograph the hat. I need to photograph myself wearing the hat. I just haven't had a second. I appreciate your patience, guys. I hope to get that out this week. I may just put like filler pictures so you guys can kind of see the hat, and then I'll take better pictures later. But I might not. I might just try and wait and get the good pictures done. We'll see. I'm working on it. I really am. And then all that needs to be done is needs to be saved as a PDF, and I can send it off. So hopefully that pattern will be out in the next week or two. Okay. I have been working on the Even Star. I am 7 rows from the end of chart 3. Let me show you. This is where I'm at now. This row above the highlighter tape will be the next row that I do. I have this row all the way through the top. So 1, 2, 3 of these rows are plain knit rows. These rows are plain purl rows. So I really only have 2 rows of patterning left in this chart. Let me get this banged out. You're not going to be able to see it very well. Put my face in front of it there. But you can see there's the even star right there. And then I'm just doing the last little bits. Stephen of Dramatic Knits is right there at the top of those crosses, so I am not very far from where he is. I need to get my butt in gear. Now, if he finishes his even star before me, that's okay. He is not okay if he finishes chart three before I do, because my goal has been to beat Stephen. Now, with the move and everything happening, I don't know when I'm going to get to the border. I know I won't be able to get to the border until I'm down in the apartment and things have calmed down a little bit. But I'm going to cast the My Wish Shawl on as soon as I'm done chart three, and that will probably take precedence over getting that border started, because that border is intimidating the crap out of me. So we'll see how it goes. What else am I knitting? Am I knitting anything else? Oh, I started another I keep wanting to call them teeny beanie babies, which is not correct. Those are toys. Another preemie beanie. This is a test skein that I dyed. This is actually the colors from one of the colorways. I'm going to see it right there. It's the same dyes as that. But I was testing a new dye technique called under dyeing. I'm not sure if this is a real technique. I made it up. Maybe I didn't make it up, but I've never heard of it before. Where I did a semi-solid color. I basically kettle dyed the skein, and then I hand painted over it, which changed the shades of the yarns and stuff. But this is how it's knitting up. You can see it's pooling quite heavily. I'm okay with that. It's a baby hat. It'll have a little bit of a spiral. It's kind of fun. These are knit on US 1 or 2.25 millimeter needles, because my twos are busy on the sock. So this is my card knitting right now. It's real simple. It's just going to be a stockinette preemie beanie, because it's card knitting and I don't want to deal with a big pattern. This colorway kind of reminds me of like Angry Birds. Like there's the red birds, the green pigs, the yellow birds, the blue birds. But that's not what the colorway's name is, but I just thought it kind of looked like that. It's kind of a fun colorway. So I like it. All right, spinning. I have been spinning. Not that you'd know it to look at it, but this is actually quite a bit of spinning. This is the Bartlett Yarns pencil roving that I've been working on. Focus. There we go. You can see it's pretty fuzzy and uneven a little bit, but it's still spinning very, very thin. There are occasional like slubs and stuff. You can see like there's some fuzz. It's not perfectly even. And you know, I actually really like that. I thought I would get bored with this colorway quickly because it's just a solid color. But I find that because the yarn keeps doing different things, I get these little noirs and neps, and you know, I get an occasional like kemp hair and all this other stuff. It's actually a lot of fun to spin. I am impressed with how thin it is. Again, you can't really see how thin it is on camera, but it's very, very thin for me. And it's strong. Man, that stuff is, even the very fine stuff is strong. And I don't know if I attribute that to the roving or what that is, but I'm really enjoying it. I weighed how much I had left. You'll notice that this doesn't look any smaller. When I weighed how much I had left, I thought this was 4 ounces, which is 113 grams, but when I weighed it, there was 118 grams left. So I have no idea how much I started with. I need to weigh the bobbins, I guess, and see how much is on there, but it's a good size amount, and it was cheap, and it's on the floor. But I'm having a lot of fun with that, so that's keeping me sane. Okay, dye pots. There has been dye pots, and there will be a shop update. The shop update is not going to be until 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, because I have to go to Bangor as soon as I'm done recording this and have a doctor's appointment, and then I have to come back, photograph, list, and update, which is going to take me at least until 6 p.m. So I'm sorry, but I'm going to do the very best I can. This is mostly fiber this week. I did mostly yarn last week. I wasn't going to have an update, but I'm broke. And I need the money for rent, because now all of a sudden I have this big rent payment that's due on the first of every month. So I'm doing the best I can, and I hope you guys will shop and shop hard. I will be closing the shop on probably Wednesday or Thursday of this week. And I won't be opening it again until after Fiber College. Fiber College is September 8th through the 11th. I hope you'll come. I am going to be putting little inserts about Fiber College in all of your packages. Just so you can see it, you can get more information even if you are on the West Coast or international and you can't come. But I'm excited about that. But I can't worry about the shop and mailing people's orders and moving and school starting and the show all at once. It's just too much. So later this week, probably Wednesday or Thursday, I will be closing the shop. And it won't be open again until the 12th, I think. So get it while you can. Okay, let's talk about what I've been dying, shall we? I'm going to move this. It's going to be a little bit loud. But I need something not on the floor to put stuff. Okay. The first colorway is the same colorway that baby skein is going to be knit out of. This is called Prism. This is the Texas Kid Mohair blend. It's blue. There's two shades of green. There's a darker green and a lighter green, a pale yellow, and like a bright sort of cherry Kool-Aid kind of red. I just love... I love the crimp on this stuff. This is 83% Texas Kid Mohair, 2% Superfine Merino, and 15% Nylon. So it would be great for socks. And again, doesn't it kind of look like Angry Birds to you? Angry Birds Rio, maybe? All right, I have three of those. This one is called Throne Room. It is purple, magenta, hot pink. This is orange, not yellow. My colors are a little off today. It was raining this morning, and now it's super sunny, and I can't quite get my colors to desaturate here. But it's an orange. And then, that's not really red, that's hot pink. And then, well, no, I suppose it's red. It's kind of scarlet. And it goes down into purple. It's pretty fun. It's bright, but fun. I have three of those. That one's Throne Room. This one is called Boardwalk Roses. I have three of these as well. Boardwalk Roses is cream, sand, a dusky oceany blue, and then the roses, which are pink and purple. So it's like walking on a boardwalk where there are roses. That's a fuzzy with some string attached. So that's Boardwalk Roses. Three of those. I have a single dye sop. This is dye sop number 2. I think I did just one. This is just a whole bunch of bright oranges. Very bright oranges. Not quite as neon as you're seeing, again, because my lights are a little bit crazy right now. But maybe if I put it... Pull it up over here. That's more accurate. All kinds of red oranges and golds and oranges. I just have one of those. My pictures when I take them are generally pretty color accurate, so you can see them there. Okay. This is the one pair of skeins that I have yarn-wise this week. This is called Lady Slipper. It is the Pin Cherry Lace. It is 80% fine merino and 20% silk, and it's all different shades of pink. It's two different dye colors that I use for this tonal, but there's easily 5 or 6 shades of pink at least in these skeins, and they do match. They're not, one's not lighter than the other, they match. So that is Lady Slipper. That stuff is custom orders. I did do some more challenging, but it's all custom. Okay, this one, I haven't officially named it yet because I just did it. Somebody asked me to do it. I think I'm going to call this Roses for Lisa. And it's a bunch of rosy pinks, dusky, rosy, mauvey pinks. This is Polwarth, which is a really fun fiber to play with. And it's done. What the heck was that? Oh, it just scared me half to death. A very dark wine, a nice soft pink, and then there's a pink in between there. That's like a true mauve kind of. So I hope she likes it. Because she's getting it if she wants it. And I have three of these, so 2 will be available for purchase. 3 if it's not what she wants. I didn't actually ask her yet. Usually I send a picture and say, is this what you wanted? But I haven't had time. Life is crazy. All right, I did do the white spruce top that is the 60% superwash merino, 30% bamboo, and 10% nylon. This colorway was a custom yarn that I did, and I love the colorway, so I did it again in fiber. It's different in fiber. It's called Golden Gate Dreams. You can see the red of the Golden Gate Bridge, blue of the ocean, light blue and white of the skies, and then there's grass and dirt in there as well. So It was taken from a picture that somebody had sent to me and asked me to make the yarn. So this is Golden Gate Dreams. I have three of those. I did three more of the ROM colorway, which is that red, orange, green, and brown. That's pretty accurate. And you can see all the bamboo in there that doesn't take the dye. It's awesome. This stuff is so fluffy. It's crazy. And then there was one more that I did. I can't not laugh when I see this colorway. I did Bright's Rainbow. This is Hoo Boy Bright. This is this bright. It's almost Day Glow Bright. Blue, yellow, and pink, and then they blend, and so you get areas that have green and orange and other places of that nature. So there's quite a bit of shades in here. There's hot pink and dark pink and light pink, and it's gorgeous. I freaking love this colorway so much. And I'm not usually like a brights kind of person, but man, oh man. I just love it. So I have three of Bright's Rainbow. And that was what I did in the Superwash Merino Bamboo Nylon Blend. This is Light Brown Merino, which I showed you 2 weeks ago. I don't know if you remember a couple weeks ago, I had a t-shirt that Lala had showed me and I'd bought it from tfury.com. It was the Fratelli's restaurant, and there was Sloth and Mama Fratelli and the two sons and all that. This colorway was inspired by that shirt. It's navy blue, and then there's just little pops of that same shade of pink. So you can see it better up here. Here's the blue, and you can see the little pops of pink. And there are undyed areas still where you can see the natural of the light brown merino. This is 100% merino. It's non-superwash, so it wool felt, but it's so soft. It's really dense too. Like there's a lot of fiber packed in here. I really like it. And there are two of those. Is that it? Really, that's it? That stinks. I wish there had been more for you guys. But that's what's in the dye pots this week. Shop update will be, like I said, at 6 p.m. And the shop will be closing on Wednesday or Thursday until September 12th. All right, growth. I send off my application to the New England Textile Association's SPA event, which takes place in Southern Maine in February, towards the end of February. It'll be like the second weekend of my February vacation. Schools in Maine closed for the third week in February, so there's the first weekend when you first get off, the week that you don't have school, and then that second weekend. I believe it's that weekend. I went last year as a consumer and loved it, so I really hope that I will enjoy it as much as a vendor. I'm sure I will. There's going to be great people there, so put that on your calendars. You should go. I also put my name in the lottery for the summer. I know it's SSK, and now I can't remember what it's called. Let me check it really quick, and I will be able to tell you. This is the Knit Girls and Karen from Round the Twist supported getaway that is going to be in June of next year. And it is going to be just after I get out of school. Supersummerknitaway.com. That's what it's called. So Super Summer Knitaway. I put my name in to be a consumer to get in. Now, if I can't get in, I've already spoken or emailed Leslie. I'd like to vend the event. Now, I realize getting from Maine to Tennessee is not going to be easy. I will find a way. I want to go. So it's a perfect time of year for me. I don't have a show. I have a show at the beginning of the month, but I don't have anything in July, so I have plenty of time to recover. My husband has already offered to go with me and drive, provided that we go to the Jack Daniel's distillery. Pretty sure we can make that happen. So if we have to rent a minivan and drive everything down, I don't care. We'll do it. We can do it. It's no big. So fingers crossed on that one. Okay. Processes. The only thing I thought I could talk about was designing. There are lots of great designing resources out there, and I'm not going to attempt to say that I'm any kind of great designer. My process when I design is generally I have a need that I need to fill. Like, for example, my husband wanted me to knit him a hat. Well, fine. So I knit him a hat. What I did was I had a need, so I cast on a specific number of stitches and I guessed. And I went through and worked it up until I had started the decreases and sort of wrote the pattern as I was going. So I made notes of like that I started with the first gray stripe. I knit it until I thought I was done. And then I went back and counted. So on my notes, it says that the first stripe is 10 rows. Then I knit the main color, the blue, again until I decided that I'd had enough, and then went back and counted. So I kind of write the pattern up as I'm knitting, just A, so that I don't forget what I did, and B, so that it's a little bit more flexible and I don't feel like I'm stuck with what I'd written down if I wrote it down before I started knitting and realized that it didn't work. I did a repeat on the sock before I wrote the chart out, because I wanted to see what it was going to look like, so I did it, and then I went back and said, okay, what was it that I did? So, that's how I do it. Write up as I go, but I do the actual knitting first. And the idea usually comes from a necessity of mine. Either I have a yarn that I want to use or somebody needs a specific item and I go from there. So that's my process. And I usually write them up in Microsoft Word or Publisher and then just save it as a PDF. Okay. Grabby hands. I've had this book for a couple of weeks now and I wanted to grabby hands it for you, but I haven't had a chance because I've had other things that I've had to grabby hands. My plate is cleared, everything is done, and I can actually finally share with you the Fleece and Fiber Source Book, more than 200 fibers from animal to spun yarn. This is by Deborah Robson and Carol Icarius, I think that's how you say it. I won this as part of the Nitty giveaway. This was that last piece that I was waiting for, and oh my god. I'm on page 107, I'm going to tell you guys that so I can come back and check it later. Okay, so this book is literally a source book. It is a go-to resource for information about fibers. As a fiber and yarn seller, the ability to speak intelligently about the wool breeds that you use is phenomenal. You know, this is the first book that has gone into detail about Falkland fiber. Now, I knew that the Falkland Islands were off the coast of South America. I knew that there was some unique characteristics of the wool. I did not know that Falkland isn't a type of sheep, that there are Merino, Rambouillet, Corriedale, all kinds of different sheep on the island, and that really the wool, the Falkland top is just a blend of those. The reason Falkland top is separated out as a specific type of fiber is because of the geographical isolation that these sheep have. They have no disease, so their fiber is not, they're not dipped in chemicals and things like that to keep them away from parasites and stuff. And the fiber is actually very, very bright white. And it is, in fact, very bright white. I knew that. This book goes into detail and explains some stuff about that. So it's pretty cool. Now, this book is heavy. This book weighs several pounds. I have not read through the whole thing. I'm getting there. You read a little bit at a time. I first knew that this book was going to be epically awesome when I realized that even the end papers are awesome. When you open the book, there's this map, Fiber Animals, the World of Fiber Animals, and each area goes into detail about the type of breeds that live in a specific area. In fact, it even goes further to say that, like, you see the bison here in the middle is this big gray area because bison originated in this whole big area. But in some other places you'll see, like, this says type A merino and type B merino. Then there's a little star there. That means that they can track the origin of a breed or a particular type of wool to that specific area. This is America, Asia, parts of Europe and Africa, and then they go into more detail, like this is Great Britain here, and you can see all of the different sheep breeds that are in in Great Britain, and it shows you, again, the highlighted areas are big areas, and then the specific starred areas are places that some can be traced back to a specific sheep, some can be traced back to a specific farmer. It's really awesome. So even in the end papers, you're learning stuff. It's pretty cool. It smells like a National Geographic. Maybe I'm crazy. But National Geographic paper is that glossy-ish paper and it has a specific smell to it. I always loved National Geographic when I was a kid, looking at the pictures, and I do appreciate the smell of that paper. It's one of the things that makes me love National Geographic. This book has that same smell, so. All right, one of the things that I love about this is that they do have pictures throughout, like in the table of contents, is what this is. And they have pictures, but they label all of their pictures. This is a yak. This is a pygmy goat. They actually label, especially like different sheep breeds that they put in through here, whatever. This says a Clun Forest ewe. So in case you're looking at this picture and you see, they actually tell you the breed of sheep. This was one of my pet peeves about the Knitter's Book of Wool by Clara Parks. Like, she has wool on the front cover of her book. Doesn't ever, at least I couldn't see anywhere that it said what the wools were that were on the cover of the book, the Knitter's Book of Wool. And there's a couple of places in there that you see pictures and they're not, like, you have no idea what you're looking at. I love that. That was very specific. So it goes through and talks about what fiber is and how wool is different from plant fibers and where it comes from and how long people have been using fiber and historic information, which is kind of nice to have. Then it goes into the different measuring systems, the Bradford count, the micron count, all kinds of places like that. That's where they talk about the Falkland Islands. They talk about shearing and skirting and all that stuff. Now, they have a very big vocabulary section. So if you've ever heard the word kemp and you didn't know what kemp is, you can actually look in here and figure it out. Okay. So part one is sheep. Oodles and boodles of wool. I really like the narrative voice in this book. The authors put themselves in the book. They say, when we were testing out this fiber, we learned this, or one of the samples we looked at did this. Normally in a reference material, the authors do not put themselves in it, and I really appreciated that these two did. That it made the book much more accessible to me on a reader level, but they go on and on about how the stuff that they put forth here is not the be all and end all, and that individual sheep's fleece, like the fleece within an individual sheep, may violate the standards of a particular breed, as well as different sheep for different areas of the same breed. So they're just wonderful. I just love it. And then they talk about like the difference between black-faced, black-face, and black-face, and these are two different types of sheep, which again they tell us. This first one is the Scottish black-face sheep, and the one next to it is the Suffolk sheep. Now, I know that other people have reviewed this book, so I'm not going to go huge, huge into it. I will say that one of the things I absolutely love are all of the pictures about what they do. They have a yarn sample, a woven sample, often also a knitted sample, the fleece cleaned, and the fleece raw. And if there's a commercially available yarn, they have a picture of the commercially available yarn as well. And it says this is from Eco Limited. I'm sure a Google search would show me that so I could find it if I wanted to. What I love more than anything are the adorable pictures of the freaking sheep. Now, I keep saying that someday I'm going to have sheep, and I've already picked out like 25 or 30 different little sheep that I really want to have because they are so stinking cute. Let me see if I can find one super quick. Some of these sheep are actually really ugly, and I don't like them at all. I'm probably not going to find them before the part that I haven't read. Some of them I don't really like, but some of these sheep, they just kill you. Okay, like the Leicester long wool is not really a sheep I find to be particularly attractive. However, these guys, the Hampshire sheeps. Care where they live. I want one. They're so stinking adorable. And then again, this one even says, you know, there's white and black varieties of this wool, so it shows you both. And sometimes they do mention when a color of a wool is different from a different color. So like the micron count is better or smaller when the fiber is smaller in diameter in the white rather than the black. They tell you that. Or if the opposite is true, they tell you that too, which is really neat because if you're searching for a fine wool, color may play a role in that. So you may want, you know, this is a great resource. This is one of those books that I will carry with me to shows. So if somebody asks a specific question and I'm not sure of the answer, I don't want to talk on my butt, I will go straight to this book and I will open it up and I will share it with the customer and say, this is what I know. I love this book. This book replaces for me In Sheep's Clothing and The Knitter's Book of Wool. Both books are good. I don't find them to be this good, at least from a business perspective and from a hand spinner's perspective. So I'll be using this book more in depth when I get to processing that fleece sampler that I got. That's going to have to wait until I move to. So that's the Fleece and Fiber Source Book from Story Publishing, Storey, story.com. And I know that you can get this from places like Knit Picks and stuff like that too. So check out, see if you can get a good sale. Go to your local yarn shop, order it. It is absolutely worth the $35 that it costs. But a lot of places have it on sale for even less. So I have got to go. I need to get my butt in gear. Geez, I'm running late. So until next week, guys, happy spinning and knitting. And thanks for tuning in.
For me, and cross the form of doorway, and I wanna pass right through it. Ride my one-eyed pony, and run across the prairie, and I know that I must go home. Never, never again will I roam. Oh, the men they fall like arrows. I never wanna fall again. Never wanna hit the floor, and I keep on falling. Yes.